The first issue in dealing with the Lordship of Christ, problem, controversy, whatever you want to call it, is that this is a very, very old theological issue that surfaced, matter of fact, it surfaced after the first 10 persecutions of the Roman Empire against Christians. And the issue during the Donatist controversy had to do with this question: is someone a real Christian just because they say they're a Christian when their lives, their actions, are the opposite of it? Particularly, people who renounced Christ and put incense on the altar to Caesar, after the persecution was over, they said, well, I really didn't mean it. I am really a Christian. I just lost my nerve. The issue was simply this: is everyone who names the name of Christ a Christian, and should you receive them as such? Or should we narrow down and say only those whose lives reflect Christian belief should be viewed as Christians? Now, of course, this is addressed by Jesus in Matthew 7, when Jesus said in his section on the Sermon on the Mount, he talked about the fact, verse 21, chapter 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not do this and did we not do that, etc. Well, the controversy in the early church boiled down to this: do we receive as Christians those who renounced Christ and proclaimed Caesar as Lord? And this was a huge controversy. There were those who said only those whose lives ultimately ended in martyrdom or consistent Christian living we should view as Christians. These other people we shouldn't even let become to members of the Christian church again. But you can see immediately the differences between the vast number of nominal people who claim to be Christians but whose lives don't reflect it, and those who are the true believers who said these people aren't really saved. Well, this same controversy boiled over in the Middle Ages. It boiled over after the Reformation, particularly in Scotland, called the Marrow of Divinity controversy. It focused around a math theologian by the name of Sandeman. Some of you may have heard of McShane, Robert Murray McShane, the Bonar brothers. This is why, particularly, Bonar wrote the book God's Way of Holiness, Marshall's book on sanctification. This ended in, again, a huge controversy in which justification and sanctification were merged in such a way that the distinction between the two once again got a little muddled. This then resurfaced once again in the writings of Charles Finney, whom I refer to as the great heretic, who not only denied the doctrine of original sin — he was a Pelagianist — he also denied that we are justified by the righteousness of Christ, because he denied all three acts of imputation. He denied that sin's Adam is imputed to us, hence he believed in sinless perfectionism. He also denied that our sin was imputed to Christ on the cross, so Jesus died as our example, but he did not die because he died for our sins. And then, as an attorney, he then saw that the third act of imputation, in which we are saved by the imputation of Christ's righteousness to our record, that can't be true either. So once he said, it is not rational that we should be punished for what Adam did, neither is it rational that we should be saved because of what Christ did, and so Christ could not be punished for our sin like we cannot be punished for Adam, Therefore, we can't be saved by the work of Christ. And Finney developed what has historically been called the carnal Christian heresy. His so-called revivals ended in a massive conversion to Unitarianism and Universalism in New England. The areas of his so-called evangelism became burned out and resistant to the gospel to this very day. He was noted by saying that anyone who prayed the prayer automatically was a Christian. And he said they didn't have to act like a Christian, quack like a Christian, look like a Christian, live like... In other words, they could be a prostitute, they could be a thief, they could... As long as they went forward in one of his evangelistic meetings at an altar call and sat at the anxious seat, he proclaimed that they were saved, just their lives didn't accept it. Now, all the theologians of his day rejected Finney's position. The Princetonian theologians at Princeton Seminary wrote books. You can look at Nettleton's book over against Finneyism. It was called Finneyism. But again, it simply focused on this issue. The many who say, Lord, Lord, do we accept them as Christians, or do we say, well, Christ wasn't really their Lord, because Jesus said, why call me Lord if you don't do what I tell you to do? So it boiled up during the Finneyism heretical movement, and it was successfully squashed, as it was in the past, by biblical theologians. Then it was started all over again by Charles Ryrie in his book, Balancing the Christian Life, where he went against what he called lordship preachers, because he had to make room in Christianity for all the nominal Christians who flooded into the churches through mass evangelism, who raised their hand, prayed a prayer, but they went on living their wicked lives. And he wants them to be able to go to heaven. And he looked carefully at the writings of A.W. Pink, of John Stott, of Charles Spurgeon, etc., and he announced that they were heretics and that they were preaching another gospel of works and were under the condemnation of God according to Galatians 1:8. So everybody must understand, A, this is a very old theological controversy. Number two, all the arguments I've given before, nobody's inventing anything new. Number three, the lordship people always won in the end, historically. And then in this case, in modern times, the opening salvos were given by Charles Ryrie in calling into question whether or not those who preach that you must accept Jesus as Lord, whether they were even Christians. So this, of course, provoked many people to rise up. One can think of John Reisinger and other Southern Baptist theologians who immediately jumped into this controversy. One can think of D. James Kennedy, of John MacArthur, of others who immediately saw that Charles Ryrie's personal attack against them and others was uncalled for, and that this was an old theological controversy. After a great deal of controversy was generated at Dallas Seminary, it finally was headed by Zane Hodges, who wrote prolifically against the Lordship of Christ message. Now, how I entered the situation is the television apologist John Ankerberg, Dr. Ankerberg, gave me a call and he said, I want you to research the issue of lordship salvation and I'd like you to arrange for a debate to be done on the John Ankerberg on this issue. So this meant I had to buy all the books, I had to call everybody, talk to everybody, I had to try to find someone in the anti-lordship versus the lordship side and try to get a debate going. Well, I failed to set up a debate for the John Ankerberg show because I couldn't get any of the big hitters. John MacArthur said he was too busy. Al Martin said he couldn't commit himself. It ended up a situation where I had to call John and say, John, I have to admit defeat. But all of my research has revealed to me that the present controversy at the end of the 20th century, the beginning of the 21st century, is unnecessary because the anti-lordship people, headed by Zane Hodges and others, and the lordship people, headed by John MacArthur, actually were proceeding on the same basic theological error that has been pointed out every single time the controversy raised its head in church history, which is this. The way of salvation and the way of assurance of salvation is another way of saying that justification is not the same as sanctification. The way that we are justified is not the same way that we are sanctified. Now, this is the Reformation distinction that was fought out at the Council of Trent and the great Reformed creeds. Justification, that is the way of salvation, is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, according to Scripture alone, and you leave everything else alone. The way of assurance of salvation has to do with sanctification, not justification. Now, in the Marrow of Divinity, a controversy with Sandeman and later with Marshall in the history of the Scottish, the Church of Scotland, it became so muddled that some theologians said, if you don't know that you're saved, you're not saved. And those who believe so strongly that we are justified by grace alone, apart from any works, through faith alone in Christ alone, then switched that over and applied it to sanctification, in this case assurance of salvation, which has to do with the quality of the Christian life, not whether it exists, but your well-being, the difference between being and well-being. And they assume that if justification is by grace alone, through faith alone, apart from any works, then assurance of salvation, sanctification, is by grace alone, through faith alone, apart from any works. Now, this basic error led to the Keswick movement, the higher life, sinless perfectionism, and you had people running down the aisle and saying, I now accept perfectionism, I accept Jesus, and claiming that they never sinned again, because they thought that sanctification has to be on the same basis as justification. Justification is monergism, therefore sanctification is monergism.